edition of Texas A&M Baseball on Fox on this Saturday afternoon. It is the Aggies facing the number 21 team in the country, the Alabama Crimson Tide. And we bring you in to the broadcast booth. Certainly glad to have you along with us. I'm Will Johnson with Mark Johnson. And last night, it was an Alabama 5-1 victory for Texas A&M. That's their fifth loss in their last six games. Our Pepsi scouting report takes us into the mind of the Aggies a little bit. How are they mentally heading into this Saturday?
Well, I think they'll be very strong. But the game is a game of failure, and the coaches work on it in the fall, starting in September. How are we going to handle the adversities of the game? And the Aggies have shown a great mental attitude. I know the coaches work hard at it, so I expect them to be ready to go into play in the now.
Pitching was expected to somewhat dominate this weekend, and last night, Spencer Turnbull for the Alabama Crimson Tide did not disappoint. He was terrific in their victory. Two good ones go today. For Bama, a left-hander in Justin Camplain. The Aggies go with a right-hander in Grayson Long.
Well, Justin's an outstanding pitcher, obviously has some tremendous stats. The one that stands out to me is the 189 batting average against him. He's a 6-foot, 180-pound young man from Jastrow, Alabama, and he's not going to be the hard throws. We're not going to see either pitchers as hard as we saw yesterday. Grayson Long comes in from Barber Hills, Texas. He's 6'5", 210, and he's had a lot of success. So I think his ERA is 1.84, so it's going to be another pitching duel.
All right, Alabama, the victory last night sent them into the lead in the SEC's Western Division. The Crimson Tide at 7-3, coupled with Mississippi State's loss to LSU on the road. The Bulldogs are 6-4. The Aggies are trying to keep up. They are currently 4-6 in the Southeastern Conference standings. When we come back, it's starting lineups and first pitch. Texas A&M and Alabama up next from College Station.
Close your eyes and picture the beauty of an orange fiery sun setting over the horizon as you enjoy a cold iced tea on your front porch. Now picture that dream becoming reality with the help of my friends at Capital Farm Credit. Capital Farm Credit provides competitive financing for many types of residential home loans, including new construction, existing homes, and home sites. When it's time for your dream to become reality, why not Capital Farm Credit? We're the answer.
Another day of action, Texas A&M and the Crimson Tide. Will Johnson and Mark Johnson with you. The Aggies, after falling last night, 18-13 overall, 4-6 in the conference. Alabama ran their record to 21-8. With their victory on Friday night, it went 5-1 to the Tide. Alabama, they will send up a lineup that looks out at Grayson Long for the Aggies. The Tide leading off will be Georgie Salem. Mikey White, the shortstop, hits second. Ben Moore had a pretty good night an evening ago. A couple of RBIs. He'll hit third. Overstreet, Wass, and Smith are big hitters. And then Elliott, he was not in the lineup an evening ago, but Elliott, the DH, is inserted today. And then Vincent and Webb. Again, a look out at the right-hander, Grayson Long. This was a guy that was very dominant, Coach Johnson, at the beginning of the season and has actually been moved up in the Aggie weekend rotation. When the year started, Long was a Sunday guy.
Yeah, he consistently went out there, and all of a sudden his earned run average is phenomenal. And then Coach Hillers, the coaches, said, hey, well, we need to do this and make a move. And of course, moved Ray back to the bullpen, where he originally started last year, and worked himself into a starting role towards the end and was dominating. And I think he looks better as a pitcher, as a relief pitcher.
Georgie Salem was 2-for-4 with an RBI. last night. Final line score an evening ago, Alabama 5 runs, 10 hits, 2 errors. A&M 1 run, 6 hits, and 1 error. The Crimson Tide on top of the standings in the SEC West. Here we go. This is game 1 of a doubleheader this afternoon from College Station. First pitch to Georgie Salem. The ball, and it's 1-0. Weather is approaching this area tomorrow. So Rob Childress and Mitch Gaspard, the head coaches, got together and decided to play two of them today. And we bring you this opening contest right here on Texas A&M Baseball on Fox. Long the 1-1. It's a foul ball. Salem finds himself down in the count.
Long has come out. He's establishing right now 89 to 91 fastball as he approaches his first at bat. And that's about normal for him. He's a big, tall guy, 6'5". A little bit of a different look for all hitters when somebody that tall rolls out.
Call strike three. Georgie Salem down looking to start the day.
You know, Will, it's interesting. Here we started off again. We got a fastball right down the middle, and he took that pitch. We had quite a few takes on strikeouts last night. I was really proud that I thought the Aggies did a great job only striking out 3 times against a dominant pitcher. But they had more the call third strikes than they did regular strikeouts. Swing.
Mikey White, 3-for-4 an evening ago. There are only a couple of guys with 3 hits last night. They were Mikey White of Bama and Nick Banks for the Aggies. And White steps in with that .309 batting average. 1-1 count to him. Good pitch on the outer portion.
Yeah, that was really a sweet pitch by Grayson.
It's Salem, White, and Ben Moore due up in the top of the first from College Station. Just missed on a 2-strike pitch.
That was a changeup. He wants to get that established fairly quick, and he threw a pretty good one right there on the outer part of the plate, a little towards the outside.
2-2. That just missed.
Grayson is, he's in the zone. I mean, he's working the zone, no big misses, and getting himself established as a pitcher that can get to the plate.
Ground ball. This is the third baseman, Ronnie Gideon, and there's 2 outs.
I'd say this about Gideon. Gideon hasn't played for a few games, and curse the ball found him right away. Had a little bit of a shaky stab at that ball and came up and kind of messed up his throwing mechanics, but got it done and they got that out of the way. That first one's always good to get out of the way.
Now you can breathe a little easier.
I can play.
Ben Moore, the Crimson Tide right fielder. Outside to start his count. So Grayson Long, his first 5 starts in 2014 were on Sundays, or in a series finale at least, and he had a .26 ERA in those 5 starts. When you do that, you're in line for a promotion, I'd say. Bumped up to the number 2 guy.
That's right.
On the weekends behind Daniel Mingdon. Foul ball.
He is all over the strike zone. He's really pounding it, coming out and trying to establish his pitches and get himself settled in.
And now for Long, his last 2 starts have been on Saturdays. Swing and a miss. Couple of strikeouts for Grayson Long in the top of the first inning, and Alabama sits down in order. No score in the Aggie half of the first coming up next.
Checking your fantasy league?
Nah, just my 401k statement.
Nice. Where'd you find the money for that?
I just been saving a little every month.
I can't seem to save anything.
Well, what about all this? What about the money you're spending?
What money? It's gone before I can get my hands on it.
I got a pizza for a Todd.
Hey, can somebody spot me?
When it comes to financial stability, don't get left behind.
It's 547.
Get tools and tips for saving at feedthepig.org.
Attention taxpayers, IRS problems? We can help you today. We've helped many taxpayers settle their tax debt for much less than what they owed. You have tax rights, and our professionals fight hard to quickly settle your IRS debt. Allow us to relieve your IRS burden today. Call now for your free consultation to solve your IRS tax problems. Yes, we can help, and all calls are confidential. Call now.
800-513-0465.
And Mundo Fox.
We are the Fox. We are the Fox.
After Alabama was sat down in the top of the first inning, A&M comes to bat in their half. It's a lineup that will begin with Patrick McClendon, who is playing in left field for the first time this year. Blake Olliman after him, then Cole Lankford. Mitchell Now was the DH last night. He catches today. Nick Banks, Hunter Melton. Melton was the Aggies' home run leader last year. Logan Taylor, Ronnie Gideon, Jay Statham. Gideon back in the lineup after a bit of an absence. Justin Campain, the lefty for the Crimson Tide, set to look in at the Texas A&M Aggies. McClendon leads it off.
Well, Champlain, he brings an 86-89 mile an hour fastball. He's a typical left-hander. He'll throw curveballs to left-hand hitters and changeups to the right-hand hitters. Both pitches are moving away.
Bit too far inside, and the Aggies have a base runner to start the bottom of one. Patrick McClendon hit by a pitch. So McClendon, one stolen base this year in two attempts. The leadoff man is on for the Aggies, Blake Olliman.
Pretty good step-off move. They're trying to get a read on him. They want to see his moves, his best moves, what he does. And so probably got a one-way lead back for Patrick at first base at this time.
Outside. Olliman, a switch hitter, went from the left side last night as A&M faced Spencer Turnbull, but back around to the other side of the plate today against the lefty Justin Campain.
Well, Olliman showed the bunt there. Right now is the team that lost the game last night and kind of not in a big role. You want to score some runs right away, and sometimes it's bunt, sometimes he's going to hit runs, sometimes he'll steal, but he's going to try to do something aggressive, something to get the guy to second base.
He just trickled foul up the first base line. Coach, the big inning last night was Alabama's fifth. They got a couple of runs to take a 3-1 lead. They held it the rest of the way, and they didn't do anything special in that frame. Laid down a couple of bunts that turned into hits, and then used the sacrifice fly to grab the lead and extend it.
Yeah, get a base on balls to the 195 hitter in the A-hole for Alabama, and then lay down two bunts and get away with both of them. Both of them well executed. And then you have the bases loaded. You get a couple of sack flies, and they pick up a couple runs and they hit. And all of a sudden, you say, "Well, what happened? The ball didn't leave the infield except for the sack flies, and those weren't, you know, crushed balls." So, but it was a turning point in the game. There's no question about that. Showing bunt
shows early. This is up the first baseline. Excellent bunt. It just stayed fair. Only play to first base. And Patrick McClendon, the runner, moves to second.
Well, an interesting bunt. The balls that go down the third baseline have a tendency to go foul, to roll off the fair territory to foul. And down the first, it rolls back in. And good teams that come on the road, that's one of the things they test on Thursday night when they come in practice. They roll some balls back down so everyone will know how that field plays. And they played it properly. They didn't wait for it to go foul. It was right on the line almost. And it came back in. They played it before they, so obviously they knew that was going to happen.
A runner in scoring position already for the Aggies.
Nice job!
A&M loaded the bases in the bottom of one last night. Couldn't get anybody across. Getting his lead at second base is McClendon. Cole Lankford from the left side. One of the best offensive Aggies on this team. 302 the average. Call strike. Good pitch on the outer half.
Well, just as Scotty Report indicated, he's gonna throw some breaking pitches to the left-hand hitters. And that typically is what happens. Left-hand pitchers throw the curve to the left-hand hitter, and then they'll throw the changeup, which will move away from the right-hand hitters.
High on a two-strike pitch.
It's interesting in baseball. You don't have a lot of left-handers that throw hard sliders that go underneath the hands of the right-hand hitters. A Casey Fossum, a Jeff Granger. That really separated them from a lot of left-hand pitchers because they threw the hard slider down and into the right-hand hitters. But most of your left-handers have a really good changeups to move away from the right-handers.
Low to even the count at 2-2. Cam Plain pitched against Texas A&M last year in Tuscaloosa. Went 7 1/3, allowed 2 runs, both earned in a Crimson Tide win. That outing marked the first time in Cam Plain's career he went over 100 pitches. A&M's first season in the SEC a year ago, they went to Tuscaloosa, dropped 2 games, and a third one was not played due to weather. It was actually started, but couldn't be completed. And we expect weather here on Sunday. That's why this, what you see before you, is game one of a Saturday doubleheader. They'll start the second one 30 minutes after the finality of this first contest. And our cameras will go dark. We won't be available for that one.
Well, we're sitting pretty good at 69 degrees, and we have a little bit of a south breeze. Not much. The wind isn't going to play in today. And it's a comfortable day at the ballpark. But I noticed, I look around, and I, too, have brought a jacket just in case it starts drizzling, which could happen late in the afternoon, according to the weatherman. Start getting some drizzles as we get into the early night.
Gorgeous evening for baseball on Friday.
Oh, boy.
Chopped up the middle. Going to be a tough play. Got to hurry and safe at first base. It's Cole Lankford. Mikey White, the shortstop, came across the bag at second, doing everything he could. To no avail, they'll be Aggies at the corner.
Well, it's a straight infield base hit. He hit a high hopper over the pitcher's head, and very hard play. The infielders are playing a little bit deep because there wasn't a man going to score, and so they want to knock the ball down until we get a ball that goes on the infield grass. And Colt beat it out. Close play at first base, but he's hustling down the line.
Mitchell now handles the catching duties today for A&M after he was the DH last night. 13 driven in and a chance here in the bottom of the first. Cam Plain starts him off with a strike.
The old saying in baseball, in this situation, you tell the hitter, hit the ball hard, but don't hit into a double play. That's always the worry. You got first and third man in scoring position, and you got a chance to do something.
That's low and inside. Inning started with Patrick McClendon being hit by a pitch.
We do have some teams in our country that really, really fall in love with the safety squeeze in this situation. First and third, scared of hitting in a double play, want to get for sure the run. Corners are playing back and drop a safety squeeze down and get a run and give an out away for it and put a man in scoring position. It's not a bad strategy. It's hard to get a big inning doing that, but there aren't a lot of big innings out there anymore. So it is something you see. The Aggies haven't shown a big propensity for that, but Florida did.
Well, with Mitchell now hitting, that's not a lot of speed.
Yeah, that's
hard for him to avoid double plays if he hits the ball on the ground in the right spot. So a 1-2 count. Hit this in the air. That's trying to land in the gap in right center. It will not. A&M will tag and try to score the run play at the plate. The throw a bit offline, and Patrick McClendon gives the Aggies a 1-0 lead on what will be a sacrifice fly by Mitchell now.
Well, you got to give the third base coach, Andy Sawyer, a credit. He's the one that sent him, and the ball brought the right fielder into the left center field area, close to second base, not by second base, but brought him in. So a little bit of a question mark whether to go or not, but he was moving a little bit, and that was the, he ends up throwing across his body and getting a little bit of a lag on his ball that went up the line a little bit. So, you know, it was a good call. It turned out good and for the Aggies. And so they got themselves a one-run lead in a ball game that they've had trouble here in the last few weeks taking the lead early.
Well, Nick Banks steps in from the left side, 3-for-4 one evening ago. He was hot against Crimson Tide pitching. We talked about that, though, on when do you send runners from third base, because you were a third base coach during your time as a head man. And the amount of outs, which there were two at that time, that plays into it heavily. Once you get to that second out, your chances are diminishing.
Sure. Yeah, you've got to gamble. You gamble more. You don't steal as much. You don't do so much things as much with no outs. And then as the outs start accumulating, then you've got to start taking chances and trying to get guys in scoring position or trying to send a runner home. And if you get thrown out, let's watch this pitch here.
Campaign from the stretch to Banks. That's outside.
If you come and watch the pregame infield outfield, the outfielders, of course, practice their throws to home plate. It's about 50-50 where they throw a strike right in there that the catcher can catch. It may be a little bit more than that, but there's a pretty decent percentage. It gives you a chance in a ball game to go ahead and take a gamble.
Another throw to first base. And along that topic, you'd like to get Cole Lankford into scoring position. And they're aware of it. Lankford, yeah, Not necessarily a guy that steals a lot of bases, although he is 3-for-5.
He's got three, and we don't have a guy with 7 or 8. He's got three, and he's a base stealer in the Aggies system.
That just missed the outside corner. A 3-1 count now to Banks. A chance to put a couple on, and behind Banks is a guy that has shown some power in his past, Hunter Melton. Chop, that is foul off the first baseline.
Nick Banks, I really like him, freshman guy. Really, I thought if you were going to pick a guy out of the offensive scheme, both on the Aggies and on the Tide, who really had good strokes and good at-bats, you would have picked Nick Banks last night. And that's pretty good for a freshman coming in to do that against a hard throw like that.
Runner is going, and that's right back up the middle. A couple of Aggies on already with a 1-0 lead in the bottom of the first.
So there's another well-hit ball. Got a little bit out in front, but he had his hands back, and he drove that ball right up the middle, and another well-hit for him.
4-for-5, that means, in this series already. So Hunter Melton steps in with Lankford running at second base and Banks at first. Melton did not get into the lineup until halfway through last season. Yet in 2013, he led the Aggies in home runs.
He's really
looking for that power again in 2014. Yeah.
He's really got an aptitude to be a hitter. He's got strong, strong hands. He leaks his body forward a little bit, but he usually keeps his hands back pretty good. And he can drive the ball to both sides of the field, although sometimes he chooses to try to pull the ball a little bit too much.
Call strike.
Yeah, there's a backdoor curveball, and that's the effective pitch against right-handers that he wants to throw it. He doesn't choose to come in down and in on him because it's not a sharp breaker. So he lays one out there on the other box and curves it into the corner, and we call that a backdoor curveball. And there it is again. And a tendency for the hitters to quit on it when it gets outside, and then they've lost it, and then the ball breaks in and catches a corner. And he's working Hunter on this pretty hard and throwing some quality pitches.
A&M won across already, but they'd like a crooked number to open this Saturday. That's high. 2-2.
That's three in a row. It'd be interesting if he's got enough courage to sneak a curveball into his hands, because he's really showing him a lot of stuff out over the plate. Got him leaning a little bit, catching the corner. And he has the aptitude to throw an 89-mile-an-hour fastball, which is plenty of velocity to get in. But whether he's going to choose to do that will be interesting on this pitch.
Foul ball.
He did come fastball. Thought he might come in a little bit more, and he may have been trying to. That was an 88-mile-an-hour fastball, but he kept the ball down. But he had shown him three breaking pitches in a row, so a change of velocity was good from a pitcher standpoint, and as coaches call the pitches from the dugout.
Just like Spencer Turnbull in the opening game of this series, Justin Campain has thrown a lot of pitches in his first inning. But he has set down Hunter Melton.
He threw the fastball in on his hands and just froze him. He really did a good job of pitching to him. Left a lot outside.
Mattress Firm.
We haven't replaced this mattress in years.
Feels like 16 years.
How can you tell that?
Well, after 8 years, your mattress practically doubles in weight from dead skin, sweat, and dust mites.
Dust mites?
Millions of them.
Seriously? Millions?
Maybe more.
According to your tag, this mattress is 16 years old.
Check your mattress tag. If it's over 8, it's time to replace.
Let's go get your new mattress.
Mattress Firm. Save money. Sleep happy.
What do I add on a Whataburger?
Grilled peppers and onions.
Bacon. Extra bacon.
Jalapenos gotta be in my burger every time.
Add them anytime to anything.
Anything you can think of.
Grilled peppers and onions. I think I have a new favorite.
Avocado just gives it a unique flavor that I don't find anywhere else.
Gives my burger some personality.
You're adding something and you're making it your own.
Every burger should be what you do, what you want.
I have creative taste buds. It's not just a regular sandwich.
This is my Whataburger.
How do you make it yours?
A&M got the leadoff runner aboard at the bottom of the first. Later scored him on a sacrifice fly by Mitchell. Now it was Patrick McClendon who came across the dish. 1-0 Aggies, and 4, 5, and 6, the heart of the order for Alabama coming up. This is after they were sat down 1-2-3 in a row in the first inning via a couple of strikeouts by Grayson Long, the right-handed sophomore from Mont Belvieu, Texas, and Barbers Hill High School.
Well, Grayson really had a great start. 14 pitches, and he gets two strikeouts, and out of there, 1-2-3, just what you would want to have. And so it's good. Well, we still got people coming in the stadium. We had 4,800 people here last night, and I think we have more already here today. It's going to get crowded here, and that's great.
Now, I think you may top 5,000.
Oh, yeah.
If they'll stick around for the second game, you're going to approach 15,000 for the weekend.
Well, it's a great day to be at the ballpark. A little bit scary because of the weather, but it certainly is nice out here right now. It's just gorgeous and great day to be at the ballpark. Bring your children, bring the family, and enjoy.
Kyle Overstreet was hitless last night. He was questionable for this series for a while. He'll get off the schneid with this pitch. That's into the gap right center field. He's rounding second, and I think for a moment, he rounded first, and I think for just a brief second, he wanted to advance, but he's held up.
Yeah, he came in here with a tender hamstring, and he hasn't had to stretch it out, and I think that was his choice because he brought both outfielders at a 90-degree angle to a ball in the gap. That's typically going to be a challenge for a double, and he chose not to do it, and I'm sure a lot of that had to do with his hamstring and didn't want to extend it.
Wade Wass comes to the plate, and he actually extends the story on Alabama's injury report because he's handling the catching duties all weekend. A lot of those usually go to Will Haney, but Haney was showing concussion symptoms earlier this week. He did not make the trip with the Crimson Tide down here. So Wade Wass, the catcher this weekend for the Crimson Tide, and last night was the first time this year that he caught Spencer Turnbull, and that can always be a dicey situation, but he handled himself quite nicely.
Yeah, he did. Will Haney is a freshman, just an outstanding young man and catcher. A great receiver, according to his coach. Caught a foul tip right on the forehead. It didn't hit him. It hit the helmet. But those will come in 90, 95 miles, even if you have the mask on, which he did, and a helmet right behind it. It didn't drop him bad then, but about two innings later, he got nauseated, and rightly so. They cautioned.
Base hit into left field. A couple of Crimson Tide runners on, and they're trying to bounce right back after falling behind in the bottom of the first.
Well, those are two well hits by both of them. So kind of be interesting to see what they do here. They've got Smith, and this has been the interesting guy that came up last night as well. He's hitting .347, hitting in the six hole. And according to the stats, of course, he's got a better output than some of the guys in front of him. But he's put into a bunting situation. Last night they chose to bunt in this situation. It'll be interesting to see what they do here and move runners up. And then you're asking your 7, 8, 9-hole hitter to drive him in. That's the question mark when you have him in that part of the order, whether you bunt him here.
No bunt shown on the first pitch, and he went opposite field past the diving second baseman, loaded in the top of the second with nobody out. The Crimson Tide with a threat to not just tie it, but to grab the lead.
Well, Grayson's into a seven-pitch inning now, and he's got the bases loaded. It didn't take too long because they hit the ball hard, and they hit it early in the count. And I think they're sitting on the fastball right now, and he's going to have to mix them up a little bit more. But they've got something going. Coach Yilders has gone out just probably to settle him down, make sure he's hitting spots and not overthrowing, and probably tell him we're going to have to get a couple other pitches established right now in the curveball and the changeup because they're sitting on the fastball.
Well, he did get the ground ball toward the middle of the infield, but both were pretty well hit.
Yeah, I thought they were hit sharply. Hard to get a big range in your infield to make a big play. The ball got out there quick. Our grass moves fast here at A&M, but it's cut short. It's a fast grass, fast infield, and sometimes for people in other parts of the country, Alabama would be one, probably have thicker grass there, particularly up north. It's a big difference up north. So you have a different type of, we have the ride down here, and it plays very, very true, but it's a fast infield.
William Elliott appears for the first time this weekend. Just his second start of the season, only the sixth game he's played in.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting. He doesn't have a lot of at-bats. He's sitting there with a .125 batting average and didn't play last night and hasn't played too much. And when your DH is sitting at your seven hole, you kind of wonder how many hitters are sitting on the bench to come in to pinch hit.
Chopped. Only play to first base and a run will score. Elliott drives home Kyle Overstreet. And we're even up at one apiece.
Well, he did what he needed to do. He was fortunate in that he got a big hop, didn't hit it real well. Got jammed a little bit, hit a big hop, so we couldn't turn the Aggies couldn't turn the double play on that. Made the only play they had. And we got a tie ball game. Man on second and third, one out now. See where the infield plays, see if the corners play in anticipation of a possible safety squeeze. First base is even up with the bag. Third base a little bit. Gideon's a little bit behind the bag.
Chance Vincent entered the series as a .193 hitter, but he did his damage against the Aggies on Friday. Two out of three, two runs scored, and he drove a man in.
His on-base average was, he got three out of four times he got on base and had a very productive offensive output for him yesterday.
It's into right field. Coming in and back out is Banks. Alabama trying to take the lead, throw to the plate. Not there. Scoring on the sacrifice fly is Wade Wass off the bat of Vincent. Bama has struck right back, leading 2-1 now.
That's another productive at-bat for him. Got an RBI. He got an RBI last night when the game was close. So they got a man on third base and two outs. Sometimes the coach wants those outfielders to throw to the guy that's tagging on the bases rather than at home if he doesn't have a shot at it, to try to discourage that, because he usually gets a slower jump because he's got to be sure the guy on third's going to go. But he threw it home.
It'll be 3-1 off this ringing single. Hunter Webb, an RBI. Scoring is Austin Smith. And the Crimson Tide with quite an answer.
Wow. They have really come back well. It's like they all of a sudden got a secret or something. Coaches, you sit there, and sometimes when this happens, all of a sudden they start ringing out. They say, well, do they have our signs? And they start watching the first base coach or somebody, see if they're peeking at the signs of the catcher. But they have absolutely hit some nice. They've got four well hits, and they punched in four hits already. plus a sacrifice fly and a 4-3 ground ball. So they're having a great inning with the bottom part of their order.
Three singles to start the inning, and then a ground out and a sack fly drove a couple home. And now the single by Hunter Webb, and you go to the top of the order with Georgie Salem in from the left side.
Webb's a base stealer. He's got four stolen bases, and so he's considered one of their runners. The highest they have is with Moore with seven. So I wouldn't be surprised to see him go, because if you got the top of your order up, it's okay to come back and start the next inning if he does get thrown out. I would think they would want to test it a little bit, particularly got a left-hand hitter. It's set for them to steal a base here.
Salem struck out looking in the first inning. And is already back around as Alabama has put up three in the top of the second. High and tight.
Well, Grayson's at his 27th pitch. He's throwing at 90 miles an hour, still working 88 to 90. Needs to get some other pitches established. Got to get that changeup established. Got to get the backdoor breaking pitch of sorts in there on these left-handers.
After moving into that number two role on weekends, it's been a little bit more difficult on long. The ERA has risen the past couple of weeks. And he just cruised through the first inning with a couple of strikeouts, set the tide down in order, but it hadn't happened for him here in the second. Fly ball toward Nick Banks, right center field, and that will bring the inning to an end. But Alabama sends seven to the plate. They get four hits and three runs. They take a 3-1 advantage to the bottom of number two.
We'll never know if somehow, in some way, we can affect the outcome of a game. But when the clock's winding down and everything's on the line, we all believe.
Embrace your past, but live for now.
Now the tour on this, cause I put it.
Texas A&M Baseball on Fox is brought to you by Capital Farm Credit. Capital Farm Credit is the best in the field for agricultural financing. CC Creations, the preferred merchandise vendor of Texas A&M Athletics. And Whataburger, proud to serve it hot and fresh 24 hours a day. Logan Taylor will lead off for the Aggies in the bottom of number two. Alabama a three spot in the top half of this inning. They're up 3-1, kind of similar to last night, although it was at a later portion in the game. Here's Logan Taylor swinging at the first pitch, popped up over the infield. Calling for it is Kyle Overstreet, one pitch, one out. But last night, A&M tied the game in the fourth. Alabama came back around in the top of five, notched a couple of runs to extend the lead to 3-1. They had an answer an evening ago, and they do so this afternoon right away in game two of the series.
That's a good point, Will. They haven't let momentum get away from them. They've come right back and answered.
Ronnie Gideon back into the Aggie lineup. This is just his fifth start.
He's got all kinds of potential to be a really outstanding hitter. Was an outstanding high school player, and they're really counting on him getting it going. And he's in a conference weekend start.
Minimal at bats. He's 2 out of 14 this year. It's a call strike.
He is throwing more curveballs to the right-handers than what the scouting report said. He's trying to catch backdoor on them and has had some success with it.
Cam Plain sat him down swinging a second K this afternoon for the Alabama left-hander.
Well, he's throwing a lot of slow stuff, but his fast stuff's pretty good. He got that one at 89 and got it up and in, which was a great spot to throw. This type of pitcher, you see these guys, these left-handers that come out there and stay out there for 7-8 innings without something that you would think professional baseball would want, but they can pitch. And he's throwing some good stuff, some soft stuff, and then he'll mix in some pretty good velocity. Not great, but good velocity. And that's why he stays out there. And that's why he has such an outstanding hits off of him. I think they're hitting 189 off of him.
Cam Plain threw a lot of pitches in the first inning, but he's got a chance to work smoothly through the second and get back on track with his count. Much like what Spencer Turnbull did in the opener. Now he's got Jay Statham down 1-2.
A little tougher matchup for Jace. I look to him to try some drag bunts before the day's over on left. But he's a good hitter. He had a tendency to get the ball in the air, but he's a good hitter.
That's in foul territory, but playable. Who's calling for it? Thinking he made the grab. As he went into the Aggie dugout, he did. Chance Vincent thought he caught it, but then he disappeared for a moment, leaning over the rail of the Aggie dugout, but he grabbed it.
I think he got the gate that opens up right there on this side of the dugout, and the gate moved, so that's what it was.
3-1, Crimson Tide, moving to the third.
Deltran Battery Tender, the most technologically advanced battery charging system on the market today. Unlike traditional trickle chargers, the Battery Tender microprocessor will determine when a battery is fully charged and automatically monitor the voltage for long-term storage. Battery Tender technology eliminates the damaging effects of overcharging. Find all Deltran Battery Tender products at these fine retailers.
Suddenlink On Demand presents Turning Your TV into a Home Theater. First, grab your Suddenlink remote and go to Channel 1. Next, select from over 10,000 movie titles, the hottest TV shows and events, many available before Netflix or Redbox. Finally, grab your favorite concession and enjoy great entertainment with no theater hassles. It's easy to enjoy the best movies, TV, music, and events with Suddenlink On Demand. Just go to Channel 1. Be sure to check out these and other hot titles available this month on Suddenlink On Demand.
For movies.
This is Real Texas Baseball.
The Rangers face the Rays on Fox Sports Southwest.
SEC West leading Alabama on the road and on top of Texas A&M. As we move to the third inning of play, Will Johnson and Mark Johnson with you in the broadcast booth. Grayson Long had a difficult second inning, trying to fire away and get back ahead of that Crimson Tide order. He'll have to face Mikey White to start this inning. It's 2-3-4. White, Moore, and Overstreet.
Well, White had a good evening, evening last night. He came out, got three base hits, and a sacrifice fly, a real important sacrifice fly in their big inning, and a good player. He was a starter as a freshman last year, and I think they led the Southeast Conference in double plays. And shortstop has a whole lot to do with that.
0-1 pitch. Chopped foul toward the A&M dugout. So White down in the count. Grounded out to third base in the first inning. Alabama took sole possession of first place in the West after winning last night, and also that was with a Mississippi State loss to LSU. Ground ball foul. League standings that are extremely jumbled. About 3.5 weeks into conference play, still a long way to go. Not sure if how many people witnessed it an evening ago, but the ending to the Auburn-Ole Miss game in Oxford was about as incredible a finish as you'll see in a baseball game anywhere. That's into right field. That's a base hit for Mikey White. Leadoff man is aboard for the Crimson Tide.
Really nice stroke, taking an outside pitch the other way, just exactly what you're supposed to do, let it get depth to the plate, and just drove a really nice, well-hit ball in the right field.
Coming to the plate, Ben Moore. But in Oxford at Swayze Field last night, Auburn and Ole Miss, game tied at 5, bottom of the 13th. With a couple of runners on, Auburn wanted to issue an intentional walk to Austin Anderson for the Rebels. The first pitch out called, it wasn't out, or at least not far enough. Anderson recognized he could swing at it, put it out of the park. Walk-off game-winning home run when you were supposed to be intentionally walked. It's just part of the wildness of the SEC West already.
No, we had talked about it earlier. It's amazing that he not only got a hit, he got a home run off a ball he thought was going to be a foul ball. You wouldn't think he would be ready to generate that kind of pop. You'd think he'd be kind of just saying, well, you know, if he makes a mistake, gets too close. And this guy drives a home run off of it.
And Auburn, they may have thought they'd lulled Austin Anderson to sleep because in the ninth inning and the 11th inning, they intentionally walked him.
Yeah.
They were trying to do it for a third time in a row.
Well, you can sure see why. You know.
Wasn't a bad call, just wasn't executed properly. So the Rebels were sent to victory at Swayze Field last night in a dramatic fashion, and you underscore dramatic there. Here in College Station, 3-1 Alabama. They've got the lead man aboard in Mikey White.
Well, they got the middle part of their order. They got 3, 4, and 5 up and in a two-run lead. The third inning of the ballgame, I don't think they want to sacrifice bunt. They want to go ahead and see if they can't punch something out and get into the bullpen.
That's fouled. It will stay in play, possibly toward the Alabama dugout, making the grab, Cole Langford.
You know, we've had 2 catches already in this game.
Right
on the rail. That's a hard play to make. You come a distance to get those plays, and you don't know for sure because you can't take your eye off the ball at the end. Am I going to hit this or not? It's going to get close whether I'll have a collision with the fence.
Texas A&M has put Parker Ray, a right-hander, in the bullpen. Ray was a weekend starter earlier this year, but has been used a lot out of the pen as of late, and he can go long relief if that's what's needed. Kyle Overstreet, the hitter. Overstreet got that big second inning started with a single. And then 3 more came after him. Alabama puts up a 3 spot in the top of 2. In the air, right field, Nick Banks in and toward the line, the grab.
Nice running catch against the glove side, so he had to reach across going full speed, which is takes a little athletic balance to do that, and made the snag on it. Might have been a little harder play than he made it look like, but it was a nice play and something that was that the Aggies certainly needed to catch.
Wade Wass singled his first time up after going hitless last night.
Mikey White doesn't have stolen bases. He's not a big base stealer, which is unusual for a two-hole hitter. But he certainly is he's a 300 hitter. I don't know if he would go on in this situation. You got to clean up hitter up. And unless he got a 2-strike count on him right away, might. But typically, you never would because the 4-hole hitter is going to hit some home runs, but there just aren't a lot of home runs out here.
Another throw to first base.
I think he was leaning a little bit. I think he had the green light and almost caught him, made him flinch a little bit.
Gets his lead once more. And another look that way.
I think the Aggies saw him leaning and think, well, maybe he will be going because it is a potential steal situation. Particularly when the 4-0 hitter, he gets behind in the count, he's liable to see breaking pitches and pitches in the dirt a little bit more.
Took a couple of steps towards second base as Long came to the plate, stopped in his tracks, and Mikey White returned to first. Wade Wass has a 1-1 count. It's high, it's 2-1.
Well, the count now has turned in the favor of the hitter, so we'll see what he does, what he steals. It certainly looks like they want to do it, although he is not a prolific base stealer.
2-1 on its way. Swing and a miss.
Fastball in. Threw him a couple breaking pitches, then he came back with a 91 up and in and just really outmatched him on that pitch. This may be something they would anticipate if they want to run. Might get a breaking pitch down in the dirt or something like that. Get a little bit tougher pitch for the catcher to throw him out on.
Oh, got him leaning, but back safely is Mikey White. The game continues.
Yeah, no, I think that's what he wanted to do. He may lose his courage. He's a sophomore, so he may say, well, you know, it's getting too close.
Another throw.
Yeah.
White takes his time getting the lead here. Wass steps back in. And a 2-2 not going to come yet.
Well, they're holding tight. You know, it's three picks in a row, and if they've done anything, they certainly have gotten the attention of Grayson Long and the coaches. And you get distracted a little bit when you want to hold a runner tight for young pitchers, and you pick, and all of a sudden you can't go to home.
Finally comes that way. And now a full count pitch coming with two outs, so definitely Mikey White on the move.
Well, first baseman's going to move back behind him probably. We'll see if Cole decides to or not, because he will be going on this.
Full up to Wass. Check swing and a foul ball. Well, Mikey White and Grayson Long have kind of taken over this game and put it towards a halt.
That's exactly right. Well, it's interesting. Sometimes the first baseman will play behind in this situation because the guy's going to steal anyway, and he's not trying to get a tremendous jump. And so you give yourself ground a little bit more to play defense. Well, we got a base on balls. Now we got you're looking at a 307 Smith again. And this may be exactly why they have Smith in the sixth hole.
Well, I'm looking at guys like Mikey White. I mean, he's got a 405 on base percentage that was coming into the day, so he could set the table. And Overstreet's been a guy that's swinging a hot bat as of late. So has Wade Wass. I mean, that can all set the table for Austin Smith, your highest average. And
Austin had a great swing last inning and took an outside pitch the other way for a line shot.
Grayson Long missed.
Grayson's having a hard time establishing the breaking pitch, catching that corner. He's just been a little wide on it. And he hasn't got one of those real biting breaking pitches that you would start at the hitter and break across because it's a little loopy.
That may have called him for a balk. He did.
He didn't step off before he broke. And you got to step off. You want to get off the mound, you step off first. So Cole Langford's going to come out and talk to him a little bit. And
well, and again, Parker Ray is in the bullpen for the Aggies, and this has been a long inning. A little bit surprising because the first inning was so smooth for Grayson Long. Three up, three down, two strikeouts, and it's been a struggle ever since.
Yeah, it sure has. The second inning was so different than the first inning, and he's facing the top, you know, the top of the order, and then he comes out and gets a back half, and within seven pitches, they had the bases loaded. It just jumped him.
Now, the balk that sent Mikey White to third and Wade Wass to second. Still Austin Smith at the plate, and now the 1-1 count, but two in scoring position.
This is a pretty critical part of the game right now. He's got to leave those guys out on the field if the Aggies want to stay in this ball game.
And if you were with us last night, you don't want Alabama ahead of you by three runs or more. it nearly becomes automatic that they win the ball game.
Well, 21 times in a row, once they get a three-run lead, regardless of when it is in the inning, they have won the game. They're on a roll on that, 21-0. The chances of that happening aren't very good, but they certainly have shown an ability to finish ball games when they have a lead.
Mitch Gaspar thought he'd have a very good bullpen before the season, and that's been the case. That's why you can uphold those kind of things.
Yeah.
And a 2-1 pitch swinging.
Good pitch. Good pitch. He started him out with a really good first strike on a low and away, a definite strike, and then he's come back up with a fastball up in the end and really made it tough on him.
So a 2-2 coming to the leading average on the Alabama team, Austin Smith. Ground ball, not going to be an easy play. Backhand and throw, and just not in time. Logan Taylor, a good play and a good throw, just had to go too deep in the hole.
Yeah, it was one of those balls hit. It wasn't hit hard, but it was hit hard enough to get by the third baseman. I don't think Gideon has a lot of range. And so Mikey... it was hit hard enough he couldn't cut the angle, so he got himself caught deep, and it was just one of those infield hits, and they picked something up on it.
So Austin Smith is 2-for-2. He's got an RBI. Mikey White scores. Wade Wass moved to third on that. Here's William Elliott. Again, I told you earlier that William Elliott making just his second start of the year. A very low batting average at 1-for-11. It means he's just 1-for-9 on the year. He hadn't got a whole lot of chances, but it's an Alabama 4-to-1 lead after A&M took the initial advantage in the bottom of the first.
Not a lot of speed at third base, but this is a first and third double steal time. Here it comes.
Throw down to second. Not in time. No effort to go to the plate by Wade Wass, so... more in scoring position.
He went ahead and ran a single straight steal. There was no attempt by Wass to move off third base on the throw to second. I thought maybe they would try a delay steal, but I kind of sensed they might do a first and third, even though they didn't have a lot of speed on the bases. And they got away with a single straight.
Chopped Gideon to try to end the inning, and he will. But Alabama tacks on another one. They got three in the second, one more in the third. 4-1, Crimson Tide.
You know, you see a little bit of everything here. Whether it's down a city block or along a country road, this is home. We're looking out for friends and neighbors. Well, it's a way of life. More than auto, home, life, fences, crops, and livestock. It's about moments. And moments worth covering are never accidents. So call 877-FARM-BUREAU. You could save up to 40% on your auto insurance.
If you're shopping for a car in Texas, you know who to click. AutoNation.com connects you to the largest selection in Texas of new and pre-owned vehicles. At AutoNation.com, shop 36 AutoNation stores across Texas, representing 22 major brands, including luxury. And every car and truck has low AutoNation Smart Choice pricing. Plus, get the peace of mind of a money-back guarantee for a low price on Texas' largest selection of cars and trucks. Just click AutoNation.com.
Texas A&M Baseball on Fox is brought to you by AT&T, the nation's fastest and now the most reliable 4G LTE network. Bud Light, it's the sure sign of a good time. Here we go. Pepsi, now is what we make it. Grab a Pepsi and some friends and get out there and live it. It's time to live for now. And the Texas A&M Foundation, your gift, your way, your Texas A&M. Giving.tamu.edu. Back for third inning action. Alabama 4-1. Top of the order for A&M, Patrick McClendon. He's responsible for the only run of the day for A&M. He was hit by a pitch in the first, came home to score later on a sacrifice fly. But since then, it's been all Crimson Tide. A&M needs to strike back, but this won't help. Pop out to start the third. Credit Cam Plain. He got off to a difficult start, and now he's working into a bit of a roll. Five straight sat down. Blake Olliman. First pitch. In the air, center field, Salem. Two outs very quickly.
Well, Cam Plain is he has gone out there and established his pitches. He's got three pretty valuable pitches. He changes a little speed on his fastball. He'll throw an 87, then come back and throw one inside at 89. But I really like what he's doing, and it's easy to believe that he has the batting average against him this whole season is 184 because he mixes pitches well.
Starts Cole Langford off with a strike. Langford, an infield single in the first to help that inning along. Just missed. 1-1.
Starting off with a curveball at him across the plate for a get him in there first strike, and then it throws a fastball low and away at 89. So that's what they're dealing with, a lot of different pitches.
Chopped. Pitcher's going to have to cover. No, that's not the case because Austin Smith will take the bag himself. The bottom of the third by in a blink. Minimal pitches being thrown by Cam Plain after a rough first inning. It's 4-1, Crimson Tide.
Unbelievable.
Shh.
In our day, we didn't have U-verse high-speed internet.
Yeah, our babysitter didn't have a million ways to serve mom up on a silver platter.
We had to count sheep to fall asleep.
And I always worried that I was creating an overcrowded sheep farm. In my head, never looked like that farmer took proper care of those sheep. Too much. A little.
Connect all your Wi-Fi-enabled devices with U-verse high-speed internet. Rethink possible.
My all-time favorite is the patty melt. It's the best burger I've had since I've been at Whataburger. My mouth is watering just thinking about it.
It's so good. You can't put it down. It's a great combination. The meat, cheese, the onions.
I love the onions. I'm an onion guy.
The Texas toast makes everything else so much better. This is really buttery.
The sauce and the grilled onions set it off.
It's probably the best sandwich that I've had.
It's like you're eating happiness.
You don't have to actually be in Bluebell Park to enjoy the festivities. But the Aggies that are looking on right now, they need their team to get on a roll. Right, it's the Tide that are up 4-1 on the road. Saturday afternoon baseball from College Station. It's a doubleheader. This is game one. A&M coaching staff looking for answers on how A&M can come back. Grayson Long back out for the fourth inning. Long started the game with three strikeouts and then has allowed six hits since.
I think Grayson's on a little bit of a short leash now. They're working in the bullpen, and he's looking at the 8-9 hole hitters, and I think Coach Childress would like to get another inning out of him and maybe get him on a roll, get the pitches established, something he's having a hard time doing. But they do have the bullpen active right now, and we'll see how they work it. This is a pretty good setup pitcher for Grayson, a hitter for Grayson to throw to.
And with Parker Ray warming up, told you that he used to be a starter, so he could eat up innings if needed, but you don't want to tax that bullpen too much with another game left in the series. Chance Vincent starts it off. Low and away. It's a 2-0 count.
Well, you don't want to let the game get away from you where you can't catch up. And three runs is about as far as you want to let it get going right here. And before you start making some changes, just to stay in the ball game.
Call strike. We've been talking about this, some of it last night. We can extend this conversation here today. Power is not as prevalent in college baseball. I wouldn't say that these two teams, A&M and Alabama, really have a lot of pop in their resume, but we've seen 24 hits this series, Coach, and all of them are singles, none for extra bases.
Yeah,
ball out of putts coming right back at us. Look out.
Scott Clendon right on the next booth. He had his hands,
radio
hands out ready to catch
needed
that.
To be ready. Dave South.
Dave was flinching. I saw Dave go down, but Scott was there.
A full count to Chance Vincent. Low and away, and he walked him. But with that power and the fact that every hit this series has been a single, it sounds unusual, but it's a bit more prevalent these days than you might think.
Here comes Coach Childers. He's going to make a change. It was a short leash, and he's going to bring a pitcher in. And so it's been a rough outing for Grayson, and that happens, and I'm sure he's disappointed. He just had a hard time getting all of his pitches established. Getting him in there in the second inning was just a heartbreak for him because they jumped on his fastball pretty good and got him going. We'll see a new pitcher.
It'll be Parker Ray out of the bullpen. Once a starter, now a reliever. And he'll be charged with keeping this Alabama advantage exactly where it is. And Long's last hitter, he walked the leadoff man. So A&M will go to Ray, 4-1, Alabama.
Well,
unbelievable.
Shh.
In our day, we didn't have Uverse high-speed internet.
Yeah. Our babysitter didn't have a million ways to serve mom up on a silver platter.
We had to count sheep to fall asleep.
And I always worried that I was creating an overcrowded sheep farm. In my head, never looked like that farmer took proper care of those sheep. Too much. A little.
Connect all your Wi-Fi-enabled devices with Uverse high-speed internet. Rethink possible.
Embrace your past, but live for now.
Parker Ray is in for Texas A&M. The Aggies trail 4-1. Ray, the right-hander, a senior from Katy, Texas. He's quite a story. He actually started his college career here at Texas A&M. He was a position player, and he did some catching. Decided that he wanted to hone his craft as a pitcher as a bunt is laid down right off the bat of Hunter Webb. He'll move Chance Vincent to second base, one out. But Ray actually left A&M to go to Texarkana College to become a pitcher and then has returned to this school after doing so. I once asked him why make that kind of move, why leave a school that you're already at just to play a different position. And he was very serious about pitching, and one of the reasons he gave, he goes, I just wanted to be more in control as a catcher and a hitter. You're doing somewhat guessing. If I'm a pitcher, I got a little more control over the game. I'm more the aggressor. So he actually said that was a factor in continuing his baseball career. So he's back at A&M. And he comes out of the bullpen here on this Saturday.
Yeah, sometimes going to the junior college and getting to play right away and getting a bucket load of innings pitched and or at bats, whichever you choose to do, when you would be sitting on a bench your sophomore year at a university. It was an aggressive move on his part.
Foul ball out of play, hit well by Georgie Salem. Salem is 0-2, strikeout looking. And he flew to right as well.
Well, as you said, this isn't an unfamiliar territory for Parker. He's come in out of that bullpen and been on base before. And so he should be very comfortable in what he's doing.
That is up the middle, but caught by Logan Taylor.
Well hit ball. And Logan, that was a sinking line drive that was curving, slicing into him. And he made it on the run. It was a nice play, not as easy as it looked.
Off the bat, it looked like it had a pretty good shot at getting into center field.
Yeah.
So two down, still with Vincent at second base. Mikey White. White is one for two. He's also scored a run. Ground out in a single. That's off the mask of Mitchell now.
You know, you mentioned the 24 base hits, but all of them singles, and not as much power. Alabama brings in more power than we've seen. They have 19 home runs, a little shorter fence at their place. But typically, we've got 10 home runs, and we're seeing a lot of singles. And then you got to put the singles together. They all got to come together. You can't get runs out of them.
Popped up, caught by Blake Olliman. That's what Alabama did in the second inning. Three consecutive singles, and then later a fourth one mixed them together. That got them out to the lead, and the Tide staying ahead as we go to the bottom of the fourth.
Attention. If you currently wear eyeglasses or contact lenses, stay tuned for an important message. Are you tired or frustrated with bothersome eyeglasses and contact lenses? If you answered yes, then LASIK might be just what you're looking for. And at the LASIK Vision Institute, our LASIK procedures now start at just $2.99 per eye. The LASIK Vision Institute's nationwide network of eye surgery centers offer the most comprehensive, reliable, and affordable vision improvement services available. With over 900,000 procedures performed since 1999, our independent surgeons are changing the way people just like you see the world. Call now to talk to a LASIK Vision Institute counselor and schedule a free evaluation. A $200 value, free. And for a limited time, LASIK procedures start at just $2.99 per eye. Plus, be sure to ask about our 0% interest finance programs.
Call 1-800-828-6337. 1-800-828-6337.
Alabama 4, A&M 1. Grayson Long, the Aggie starter, has been chased from the game. Parker Ray has come on. Not a good day for Long. Is an excellent first inning. Couple of Ks. And he set the Crimson Tide down in order in the first. But after that, six hits and four runs allowed. Those first five games as a Sunday starter, sparkling ERA. It's been tougher on him since being moved up in the rotation. And the Aggies will ask Parker Ray to eat up some innings now. And the offense, the bats got to heat up. Only two hits right now for the Aggies. And they'll try to get back this into this one. A long way to go, though. Only the bottom of the fourth. Mitchell now drove home the only run of the day for the Aggies with a sacrifice fly in the first, plating Patrick McClendon.
Started Mitchell out with a get him in a breaking pitch, kind of a backdoor snuck in, and then he came with a changeup right there, so he's mixing that pitch in. So Mitchell's seen two slow pitches.
Trickling ball under the glove. We saw Austin Smith. I want to see if that hit the lip where the grass transitions to dirt on the infield. That last bounce, that may have been what it hit and got right under the glove of Austin Smith. He expected that, obviously, to bounce a little higher instead of hugging the dirt.
Well, it happens, and that was a slow hit ball, which he probably could have caught barehanded, and so it makes it look even worse. But there is a cut of the grass there, although there isn't very much of a lip on these fields.
They are well manicured. Two errors by Alabama last night. This is their first on Saturday.
He threw Mitchell. He threw back-to-back changeups to Mitchell, and Mitchell hit that one on the end of the bat and wasn't staying back. So he's really mixing the pitches up well.
Nick Banks 4-for-5 in the series, but finds himself down 0-2 against Champlain. Lefty on lefty matchup. That's in the dirt, and a base for Mitchell now, moving to second.
Got a wild pitch. That was a breaking pitch. He just he really pulled that one to his glove side and took a weird hop off the glove and got a man in scoring position.
Nick Banks represents the last hit for A&M. That was back in inning number one. Mitchell now in scoring position. Banks and some power behind him and Hunter Melton. That missed 2-2. Banks trying to work his way back after falling down in the count 0-2. Champlain not ready to come to the plate. Overcast skies. And, you know, we may get a pinch runner here, and this is in an odd spot. Mitchell now is coming out of the game, and Troy Stein, who handled the catching duties in the opener, will run for it. And this comes with a 2-2 count in the middle of an at-bat. You wonder if that means there's a Mitchell now injury of some sorts, or...
I don't know. It is a strange time. It's strange to put Stein in to be your base runner, even if he's going to come in the catching position, except you may want to keep those base runners that you've got on the bench for later on in the ball game. But to put in a guy, and he's got average at best speed, to put him in to run at second base.
This is chopped. It'll advance the runner. Banks is an out. Moving to third, Troy Stein.
Well, it was good at bat. He moved the runners, and that's what that was what was critical in that particular at bat, is to get the ball so the runner could get on into third base. So the call comes out to hit the ball on the right side of the base, the infield. Or you could actually say from the shortstop on over, although you got the pitcher could flag one of them. So he moved the runner and got a man on third base in less than two. So this is important at bat right here. This runner's got to score when you get this opportunity. The infield's back. The call is to stay out of his two-strike count and to not get the ball in the air. So you want to stay above the ball and just get the ball in play and get a run. The RBI is more important than the hit right now. They've got to get RBI. They've got to get runs.
Hunter Melton. He burst onto the scene in Hoover, Alabama at the 2013 SEC tournament with a few long balls against very good competition, the likes of Vanderbilt and Florida. So they expect it to provide some power. He is still looking for his first home run this year. 2-2 count now.
Well, coaches want him to cut down on that swing. That's a big swing. Now he's got two strikes. He's got to keep his body balanced and stay in a power base and just hit from there, take a shorter stroke, and be sure he gets it in play.
Struck out looking his first time up. This is trickled foul off the third base line.
Really, really impressed with Champlain. He uses all of his pitches. I mean, he's a guy that's just going to stay out there a while because he has control of three pitches.
Big sequence, big at bat, 2-2 pitch, and now you go to a full count.
Tried to get a backdoor pitch in there and got a little bit low on him. That was 75 miles an hour, so he really changed it, and he changes speeds on his same pitches sometimes.
Missed low, a couple of base runners now for the Aggies at the corners. The walk to Hunter Melton, Logan Taylor coming to the plate. Taylor 0 for 1 with a pop-up. Champlain, after cruising through innings 2 and 3, run into a little bit of trouble at the bottom of the fourth, trying to keep the Crimson Tide out in front.
Not really a first and third situation here. You got two runners that aren't real fast, and you've got you're down three runs, and so you try to make something happen here at the plate if you can.
Logan Taylor, a call strike to start his count.
It's a backdoor curveball. Started outside and brought it into the corner there, and he's done that quite a bit. It's a good pitch and gets him ahead of the count, and it really improves the chances of winning.
That's low. Good block by Wade Wass. Obviously very important with the second run of the day for the Aggies, 90 feet away. And a pass ball or wild pitch also puts another runner in scoring position. Stein was inserted for Mitchell now moments ago as a base runner. He'll likely be behind the plate as a catcher the rest of the way. That's inside, and it's 2-1 to Taylor. You see on deck behind Taylor, Ronnie Gideon. Hard hit. That's inside the line. A fair ball. It'll be 4-2. And the Aggies are rounding the bases. They'll try to score. Hunter Melton as well. Play at the plate. He's safe. And the Aggies are within a run on the 2-RBI double off the bat of Logan Taylor down the line and left.
Well, a breath of fresh air for the Aggies to get back in the ball game. A little tough of a call for Andy Sawyer is the third base coach, and they had a slow runner at first, and Melton Hunter, so he decides to send him, and it certainly pays off. It's a good gamble, and sometimes when you're behind and you got to make things happen, you just roll some dice, and they rolled in the favor of the Aggies on that call, and it was a good call, and a great hit by Logan as far as sparking his team and getting some air flowing in the dugout.
Taylor now has 10 RBIs this season, scoring before Hunter Melton was Troy Stein. 4-3, Crimson Tide. This one just took on a little bit of a new life this game. Chopped into left field. Not a good jump at all at second base for Logan Taylor. He will have no chance to score.
Well, that's a hard read. You don't know if the shortstop's going to catch the ball, and then you're a dead duck going to third base, because that's going to be his only play. Can't throw across to first. So you have to see the ball through when you have a question mark there. And unfortunately, you know, he's only able to get third base. But the Aggies have something going. They got first and third with one out. And Alabama's going to talk it over with the pitcher.
So Ronnie Gideon, the single, moving Taylor to third. Jay Statham coming to the plate. And Cam Plain, a rough first inning, allowed a run, smoothly through the second and third, but now trouble again in the fourth, coach. And part of this is to settle Cam Plain down, perhaps, but you saw 28 pitches in the first inning, 20 in this frame, after about as easy work as you can do in the second and third.
Yeah, they're sending some people down the bullpen. They haven't got anybody ready, so I don't think it's ready to get, he's preparing to get the next guy in there. Just want to slow the game down to get somebody down there to get loose. They're putting on their first and third defense, which again, we don't have good, a lot of speed at first base, so it probably isn't a situation, but Jay Statham's up and see what he's got to offer here.
Jeffrey Bramblett is one of them heading to the bullpen for the Crimson Tide. Jay Statham shows bunt. That's a ball out of the zone. Bramblett, who now warms up, he teamed with Cam Plain and Jay Shaw to throw a combined no-hitter earlier this year against Mississippi Valley State. It was the first nine-inning no-hitter for Alabama in 72 years. Bunt shown again by Statham. That is outside, 2-0.
It's a little bit of a tough thing. He's already showing the bunt twice. We got the third baseman in, and he's looking for a safety squeeze, I would think. A hard read for the runner on third. It's got to be away from people and give him enough time to get the home plate.
Swing and a miss. Throw down to second base, and they got Ronnie Gideon. Caught stealing, and now two down. Still with Taylor at third base. He made no break toward home.
No, you wonder if the hit and run might have been on or something to protect the runner, Gideon, who isn't a real big stolen base guy. But more than anything, it's to get aggressiveness going, get a flow going, and hopefully you can make some things happen and not sit back.
High and away. Full count now to Jay Statham. So Taylor, the 2-RBI double, got the Aggies closer. Statham would like to tie it here with a base hit. That's off the end of his bat. We remain full. Yeah. Champlain from the windup with a runner on third. That is looped center field. Nice running catch by Georgie Salem.
Yeah, nice jump by the center fielder. Had an angle on it right away. His ball in into his glove side. Nice play.
Aggies get a couple of runs. They're within one, 4-3. Crimson Tide.
Fox Sports Southwest is your home for Texas baseball games all season long. And here's how you can join the excitement. Stop by your local participating Sonic Drive-In and enter for your chance to win during the Sonic Slam inning. Then watch during the sixth inning of our games to see if you might be a winner of a Sonic gift card, our nightly prize jackpot, or even $25,000. Brought to you by Fox Sports Southwest and Sonic Drive-In. Sonic, America's Drive-In. This is how you Sonic. Geico Motorcycle. See how much you could save.
Logan Taylor, a two RBI double inside the line. Scored Troy Stein. And then big Hunter Melton to the plate. A couple for the Aggies, and they now trail 4-3. Parker Ray entered the game in the last inning. So a big at bat for Taylor. Kind of changed the complexion of this game.
Sure enough. Really got us back, or got the Aggies back in the game in a 4-3 ball game. And now it's got a chance to believe and see hope.
Also in the Alabama bullpen at this moment is Thomas Burrows. Now, you would call him their closer. He finished the game last night, Coach, but kind of interesting to see Burrows back in the Bama pen.
Yeah, we talked about it last night that he came in and really wasn't a tense, close situation. They had a three-run lead, and so it surprised me that he came in last night because of the possibility of a doubleheader today and then being used two times today. But I think one of the reasons they are 21-0 with a three-run lead or more is because the bullpen has been good, and he brings out the good guys.
Ben Moore is the leadoff hitter this inning, and he will reach base. Ground ball single into left field for Alabama. Fourth inning in which they've got the lead man aboard. They've done it every inning since the first.
Yeah, they did quite a bit last night, too, and ended up being the big part of the fourth inning. It was a walk-off, a leadoff walk-off, a walk to the eight-hole hitter. Got pretty good speed at first base in Ben Moore. He is a stolen base type guy. Don't know if they're going to bunt with their four-hole hitter. I would think they wouldn't. I think they would choose. Well, there it goes. I was thinking they would choose if they to steal a base rather than give up a bat and give up an out. But they've got a lot of respect for Troy Stein. I know teams don't run on him very often.
And also that Logan Taylor double an inning ago. Well, there it was, the first extra base hit of the weekend.
Yeah, there you go. We need to talk about it more. No, it's fun to see extra base hits and see the relays and all of those things that go into the beauty of the game. Extra base hits are one of them with men on base. You get a big picture of a lot of different options.
Ben Moore back diving safely. Well, he can go 6 of 7 stolen bases this year. Ben Moore. High, and it's a 1-2 count to Kyle Overstreet.
Noise in the background is a train coming through. It's the 325. It's a little bit late. It's going north. But it's part of the atmosphere in the event that happens at Olsen Field.
First one late in Olsen history then. We talked about last night, they've all been on time.
Well, they usually are. There may have been something down in the Houston area or between here and Houston that slowed it up, a little traffic or somebody stuck on a track or something.
Maybe proceeding with caution with some weather may possibly come. Runner is going. Foul ball right back at us, straight over our head. Stick with a 1-2 count to Kyle Overstreet, and Ben Moore's got a retreat. A&M took the initial lead with one in the bottom of the first. Alabama then scored four straight, three in the second, one in the third. They had the 4-1 lead. A&M answers back with two in the bottom of the fourth, but Bama has been doing this all weekend. It seems when the Aggies scratch for something, they can come right back, and A&M gets two in the bottom of the fourth. What do you know? The top of the fifth begins with a couple of singles from Crimson Tide hitters.
Well, certainly that's true, and we may see a bunt situation. Obviously here, and again, with the five-hole hitter in the olden days, that would be hit away, and it's still early ball game, but with the new bats and not as many doubles and triples that we've talked about already today, might see a sacrifice bunt right here, and we'll kind of see how the defense plays it and see whether they're going to bunt with their five-hole hitter who is hitting 282.
Looking around the SEC, Florida leading Kentucky in the ninth, 11-8. Kentucky beat Florida yesterday 17-1.
Beat them to a pulp. Florida must quit putting their pitchers out there. Just got away from them, saved them for today.
The Gators are biting back today. Auburn and Ole Miss after that strange game last night, scoreless. Georgia and Missouri played 13 innings as well. Two games in the SEC on Friday night went 13 innings. Wade Wass, low and away.
It's like he's hitting all the way.
Wass singled in the second, walked in the third. He's reached base both times he's come to the plate. He's also scored a run. Wheel around and no throw. If Alabama gets a run or two here in the fifth, I'll officially be thoroughly impressed with the way they don't blink when somebody jumps out at them.
Right.
Like the Aggies with that sending a message with the two-run double an inning ago. And here comes Bama once more. Wade Wass lost the bet. He's got to go all the way to the brick wall behind him to go get it, get some help from an Aggie bat boy. But, yeah, let's get some grip out here.
Yeah, you got to put some pine tar on it. Yeah, get a little bit more grip. Well, it's not a real hot, humid day where you see that. I don't know why that happened, but nonetheless, it's part of baseball. Get some pine tar. Stick to the bat.
I mean, this wasn't just a soft losing of the bat. I mean, that's a throw.
Yeah, you wouldn't want to be sitting on the back end of that one. That's a helicopter coming at you.
He steps back in with a 2-1 count against Parker Ray. Well, getting eventful down there at the plate. He loses the bat. That's off the helmet of Stein.
Yep. Doing some damage.
Nobody's safe down there. So Troy Stein, after pinch running an inning ago, in the ballgame as the catcher. He wants to talk with Parker.
Yeah. Right?
Start to get a few of the Aggie infielders trickle in on this conversation. Taylor
strange.
And Gideon.
Yeah, a little strange.
Well, Ray has been throwing to Stein for quite some time, so it wouldn't suggest that this is a problem with signs.
No, I wouldn't think so. Maybe a little quarrel with the pitch is going to be. It may have gotten a sign from the coach, the catcher, to the pitcher that says must throw. Most of the signs say if you want to change it, fine. But he may have wanted to change it, but got a must throw.
Ground ball foul.
Most of your pitching coaches are sitting in the dugouts. They're calling the pitches, and they will give a lot of option, a lot of leeway to the pitcher himself. If he doesn't like the sign, doesn't feel good about it, he can switch it up. But there are signs that come in with a different sign that says, this is a must-have. This isn't a question mark one. And there may have been a little bit of a conflict there.
And Rob Childress, the head coach, he calls the signs. He handles the arms for this team. That's in the dirt, and a runner will advance, not both of them.
Yeah.
Ben Moore goes to third. Overstreet decided to stay put at first.
I think Overstreet is really taking care of his hamstring. He didn't hustle down hard on that his time with his base hit to right field, which wasn't a real hustle, but he looked tender. And we saw it the first inning when I thought he could have stretched the ball into right center field that took the outfielders at a 90-degree angle to the ball. And he's held up at first base, so he may have been hesitant. Normally, if the lead runner goes on a pass ball, wild pitch, the backup runner's going to go too. So
they're at the corners with nobody out. That's a foul ball. Pretty good competition, Ray, against Wass. This
yeah,
is bad.
A lot of bat here. A lot of foul balls, throwing bats, and balls off helmets.
Eventful, at least.
Yeah. Getting some damage control here.
And they're taking it the distance. Another full count pitch coming. That is deep into left. Oh. A no-doubter. Gone off the bat of Wade Wass, and Alabama has answered again. Three-run shot, and the tied up 7-3.
Well, I'll tell you what, you take a picture of that one, and the at-bat itself was a battle to bat. You know, constantly battles, and threw him a lot of different pitches. He fouled some off and really battled it, and stayed in a really nice stroke, drove it out of the ballpark. So you give a lot of credit to him, and it was a good battle. Parker was giving him all of his pitches and coming at him, but he won that battle.
We're starting to see the extra base hit, Coach, and they are driving in some runs.
Yeah,
two for the Aggies an inning ago, three on the long ball by Wass here. Andrew Vincent is in the Texas A&M bullpen.
Well, another response by Alabama to the Aggies making a run at them the previous inning, and they come back and answered immediately.
Well, you've talked about how possibly the biggest requirement to play in the SEC is mental toughness. If you can answer the way they have, that shows quite a bit of it.
Yeah, sure enough does. It means this game's not over. They know they got plenty of room, and they've got confidence in what they're doing. They're playing well, and that happens. You start playing well, and you just really feel confident.
Another Aggie has scurried out of the dugout and headed to the bullpen. Actually, quite a few of them. Corey Ray was heading down there. Now Ryan Hendricks. That is outside for a ball. But it's a clinic and a lesson these last two frames. What the extra base hit can do for you. I mean, a double and it plates two. A home run, it plates three.
Yeah.
If you can start stringing them together and get the big hit, in the snap of a finger, you can change a ball game. And we've gone through two gamuts of this game already, as you see the strike out there by Smith. Uncanny of him. He's been excellent all week.
Yeah.
He was 2-for-2. But games can change in a hurry with the big hit. The Aggies got back into it with a double. Bama extends it and gets a comfortable lead again with the long ball.
Sure enough. And when you sit and watch 24 hits in a row and they're all singles, you sit there and you forget about what a double does, the difference of a double, the difference of a triple and a home run. That was a good response by Parker coming back and striking Smith out, who's really had two hits already today, hit the ball yesterday, and nailed him.
That has trickled up the third base line off the end of the bat of William Elliott, but it goes foul. Elliott is 0-for-2. Minimal playing time for him this year. And he is 1-for-10 in 2014. Alabama's offense has come on because we talked about their pitching was excellent at the start of the year and has held steady, but they didn't get a whole lot of run support early in the season. But that's not necessarily the case. And you can go back to last Friday when they played Ole Miss And Spencer Turnbull had what was his worst start of the year, yet Alabama still won the game 7-6. So this offense starting to come on. They lead the SEC West. If this continues, look out. A force to be reckoned with, no doubt.
Well, if they can bring offense into it, then they separate themselves from other teams in the conference that we've seen. And as we look at stats, there aren't a lot of real offensive, powerful teams out there. And certainly Alabama's putting on a pretty good display today and last night.
Ground ball, Lankford. He'll have to pitch to Parker Ray. Two down. 3-1 on the putout. Chance Vincent will come to the plate. A 193 hitter coming into this series, but he had two hits and an RBI last night. He's already got an RBI today. Vincent perhaps turning a corner. Vincent, both times he's come to the plate today, he's been productive because he got a sacrifice fly and an RBI, and he also walked.
Sure did. And so his batting average certainly doesn't equate to what he's produced here in two games.
Check swing, appeal to first base, and they'll ring him up. Nelson Graham, umpire over there, said he went around. Tell you what, you look at that batting average, and this is down the line. Well, he stays hot. Extra base is coming for Chance Vincent. A double, and he'll stop right there.
He did that last night, reached out for a ball that probably shouldn't have been pulled and turned on it and got it down the left field line. And he's going to remember Bluebell Park at Olson Field.
Perhaps what turned his season
around.
Be
telling the grandkids about it or something.
I was just going to say before he deposited that pitch down the left field line that 213 is not a heck of an average, but it looks a whole lot different than 193. That's two in front and the one in front's the key.
Sure enough. He came in hitting below 200, and he's getting his batting average up. And he is a good athlete. He's a good player. Plays third base and gets a ball across the diamond well. But he certainly hasn't shown about struggles that he's had prior to it. He looks like he's a regular 300 hitter this weekend.
Hunter Webb, seventh man to the plate in the top of the fifth inning. Alabama did this in the second. They sent seven men to the dish and scored three runs, exactly what they've done thus far in the fifth. In opposite ways, though, all singles in the second inning, a three-run homer here in the fifth. That just missed. 10 hits in this one already for Alabama. They had 10 last night. Ray taking his time from the stretches. Vincent gets his lead at second base. That's back up the middle, but a great defensive play by Parker Ray.
That was a shot.
Defensive, yes. He's just trying to get out of the way of that, and he snagged it. Alabama has taken a 7-3 lead. Three runs in the fifth on a three-run homer by Wade Watts.
So what flavor is Taco Bell gonna make next?
First nacho cheese, then cool ranch. Now what?
Can you think of anything?
Nah, I got nothing.
No, I think it's going to be simple.
What?
Wait, I feel like we should know this.
What flavor are they gonna make next?
Action!
I have no idea.
It's more obvious than you think. The all-new fiery Doritos Locos Taco. A lot of fire and a hint of lime.
It's fiery.
Whatever, Mike.
CC Creations, the largest custom screen printing and embroidery company in Texas, as well as the preferred merchandise vendor for Texas A&M Athletics. From decorated t-shirts to promotional items, embroidered golf shirts, caps, along with signs, banners, trophies, and awards. CC Creations and the Aggies have you covered. Call CC Creations 979-693-9664 or visit the website cccreationsusa.com. CC Creations, building better relationships throughout Texas for over 30 years.
7-3 Alabama. Another three spot in a frame for the Crimson Tide in the top of the fifth. A&M had fought back, gotten to within 4-3 after four, but a Wade Wass three-run homer over the left field wall with one swing of the bat changes the complexion of this contest yet again. And now Cam Plain back out. He's had two very smooth innings, two in which he struggled, but with a four-run lead now, perhaps could pitch a little more comfortably. A&M going to have to find a way to fight back once more after Alabama, like they've done all weekend long, has had another answer to an inning in which the Aggies put up runs.
Yeah, if you're going to try to get a comeback going, which the Aggies are, it's nice to have the start of your lineup. You don't have the 8, 9, 1, 2 up. You got 1, 2, 3, 4. And it's your best opportunity to get an inning going.
When the Aggies got within a run an inning ago, the work in the Alabama bullpen was pretty frantic. But now that they've got the four-run advantage, it's stopped. Everything has ceased in that right field pen. Ground ball, Mikey White. 6-3 on the bouncer for Patrick McClendon.
Wait a minute. Catcher interference possibly.
Uh-oh. Now he'll stay at first base. Yeah, I think you're exactly right.
Haven't seen the umpire signal it to everybody, but I think that is the only way it could have been. The bat touched the glove of the catcher as it came through, and then he hit the ball, and so it's catcher interference automatically gets you on first base.
You need base runners, and you'll take it.
Any way you can get them.
McClendon, the lead man aboard. Blake Olliman to the plate. That's a bouncing ball into left field. So the first two men aboard, a catcher's interference and a single by Olliman. And the Aggies trying to show some fight here and get back at the Crimson Tide.
Well hit ball, and this is just what the doctors ordered for the Aggies. If they're going to come back, they get the men on base, they're within reach, and they got their 3, 4, and 5 hole hitters up to get to move the runners. And
Cole Langford's a guy they've asked to do it quite a bit. He's come through on several occasions. He's 1-for-2 in the game, 2-for-5 this weekend. Langford, 23 runs driven in. In the spot the Aggies want him in with a couple aboard. Call strike on the first pitch from Cam Plain. Langford, the 23 RBIs, easily the team lead. The next closest is 16. High.
There's a possible play that could develop. I don't know if they could do it, but a pick at first base with a left-hander, and the first baseman's playing behind the runner. And we're getting a pretty good lead over there. Alleman's off there, and the pitcher lifts his foot, and the first baseman breaks and comes in behind. And, of course, first base coach is watching as well, so might not happen.
That's back up the middle into center field. One run will score. 24th RBI of the year for Cole Langford. Patrick McClendon across the dish. Still two on and nobody out. Now it's 7-4, Alabama.
That dugout's bullpen's moving again for Alabama. That is a good start with catch interference and two base hits. We got a man on first and second now. Stein, who was a replacement, coming in for now. You would think, well, it's too bad, you know, now is in the four hole, and now you're replacing with a substitute. But Stein's been in the four hole before. He's been in the middle of the lineup for a lot of times for the Aggies, so this isn't an easy out for anybody.
It's Jeffrey Bramblett that's gotten back up in the bullpen for Alabama. So 7-4, the Aggies trail. Two men aboard, nobody out. Stein inserted in this game an inning ago. Last night was 0-for-3. Chopped. That could get into left field. It won't, but it's off the glove of Mikey White and far enough away from him for Blake Olliman to score. A&M swinging right back. These two teams aren't going down without throwing some punches at each other. It's 7-5.
Well, it was a good pitch and got out in front of it a little bit, Detroit, and he got a big hop that went into the hole and just a hair out of reach of White, and trickles out in the left, and Alleman was on the go all the way and sent him on in.
And now the hottest bat in the Aggie lineup, Nick Banks, who is 4-for-6 against Crimson Tide pitching over these couple of days. The Tom Ball freshman showing bunt, pulled back. That's out of the zone, 1-0.
Well, when you're the home team, you can play for Tide a little bit more. It's not in that spot yet, but it's getting close to we're in the fifth inning. And not a bad call to the potential move the runners over and get another base hit and score into the tie of the ball game.
That's laced over the glove of Mikey White. Runners will hold up, just going station to station here. That's all they can do. They had to pause to see if Mikey White could get up the ladder and make the grab. He almost did. Now they're loaded with Aggies. Still nobody out.
Well, you know, he had two hits like that last night where he stayed inside the ball and absolutely drove it into left center field. I was a little cautious there whether Mikey was going to be able to catch that. I don't know if it tipped off his glove or not. It looked like it might have, but it certainly was close as to whether he could catch that ball or not. And coach is coming out trying to slow this thing down. He's going to bring somebody in.
Now, doing the most work was Jeffrey Bramblett. And I would guess that's who you're going to see. This inning started with a catcher's interference that put Patrick McClendon on. And since then, four consecutive singles by Alleman, Langford, Stein, and Banks. And it is Jeffrey Bramblett coming out of the bullpen. 7-5, Alabama leads. But the Aggies fighting back and still threatening.
Trip of the imagination can take us anywhere in space and time.
It's an all-new cosmos adventure from the birth of astronomy.
This is one of the first telescopes.
To lost civilizations.
The world's first book burning.
To the edge of our solar system and beyond.
We have only just opened our eyes.
Don't miss Cosmos, a space-time odyssey. All new next week on Fox.
DeNove is here on Fox Sports Live.
Kevin Durant's hot streak, has everyone impressed?
I was watching on Fox Sports 1.
Let's throw it to you. Kenny Florian.
More from Peter Schrager.
Insider Ken Rosenthal.
Over to Carissa and the Pens.
Oh, boy.
The great Phil Jackson.
Rafael Nadal. Jimmy Johnson.
Johnny Manziel.
Seo Quig.
Tiger Woods.
Ronaldo.
MVP LeBron James.
Jay, I don't know about you, but I am spent.
To find your channel, go to FoxSports1.com.
Aggies firing back at Alabama. It's 7-5. A&M entered the bottom of the fifth, down by four. They've cut the lead in half. There are still bases loaded. This was Troy Stein with a single off the glove of Mikey White. Cole Langford, a single in this inning as well. Four consecutive singles in the fifth have chased the Alabama starter. Justin Camplain, they'll bring on Jeffrey Bramblett. Told you earlier that Bramblett teamed up with Camplain and Jay Shaw for a combined no-hitter earlier this year. It was Alabama's first nine-inning no-hitter since 1942. That is far from the case today. Bramblett is trying to keep the Crimson Tide in the lead as the Aggies have now ratcheted up the hit mark all the way to 8 and 4 in a row. Last four hitters to come to the plate have been successful.
Well, Bramlett's a freshman. He's 6'2 and 220 is and a big man standing out there. He's going to be an 88-89 guy, fastball slider pitcher.
Hunter Melton, first man he faces, bouncing ball, knocked down on a diving effort. There's one out at second, but they can't get Melton at first, and Langford will score. Good play by Chance Benson,
yes,
at third, unable to turn the twin killing.
definitely a nice play. It looked like we might have another ball get through the infield, and didn't happen there. But it did get a run in, and it stayed out of the double play. So that's a good thing. We got first and third. We got one out. Catcher is calling plays out to the defense. So he has choices. He could throw it back to the pitcher, as though it looks like it's going to be to second base, and pitcher intercepted. He could fake to second, throw to third. He could go ahead and throw through, and then the third baseman would let him know he's coming, or he could have the shortstop just take it right, left, and then come towards home and throw it to him. A lot of options.
Still just one out, so an RBI situation for Logan Taylor. He delivered the big hit an inning ago, two RBI double. Got A&M to within 4-3. Alabama extends the lead in the top of the fifth. Now the Aggies right back within one. Outside, past the catcher. This game is tied. Troy Stein coming home on the wild pitch. Four in the inning for A&M. 7-7 even up.
Well, we got us a ball game. This has been exciting because it's been give and take, give and take, give and take. And you get a lead, the other team comes back. The other team gets a lead, and then the other team comes back. And so it's an exciting ball game. We got a packed house almost. It's great baseball atmosphere, and into both bullpens right now, and it's a dogfight.
Still an RBI situation for Logan Taylor because Hunter Melton moved to second base on that wild pitch. 7-10-2 for Alabama, 7-8-0 for A&M. Just when the Aggies would strike, Alabama would just do a little bit more. A&M doesn't let them get too far away. Back to a 7-7 game. And Logan Taylor with a chance to put the Aggies in the lead. One down, bottom of five, and now a 3-1 count. As immediately Bramblett has had a little trouble finding the zone. And he just walked him. That was way outside and low.
Yeah, he may not stay out there long if he doesn't show the coach he can control the strike zone here pretty quick. They've got somebody up in their bullpen to answer before it gets away from them. But it's interesting how these innings start. Most of your innings, the leadoff guy gets on first base. And we've seen that last night, and we've seen it this ball game as well. They're going to come out and talk to the pitcher a little bit, probably to give that guy in the bullpen a little bit more. Is that Burroughs down there?
That's actually Jay Shaw, combined with Bramblett and can't play on that no-hitter. But Burroughs was up at a point in time, but Shaw doing the most work in the Bama pen. Bramblett, it's just a matter of finding the strike zone now. You're not worried about who hits you. You're going to have to throw strikes if you want to stay in the game and keep this contest knotted at seven. Ronnie Gideon will hit. Gideon, a strikeout swinging in the second and a single in the fourth. He's 1-for-2. Call strike, comes back to start his count with a pitch in the zone.
That was an 88 fastball. That's where he's going to work. Going to hit 89 maybe. Then he's going to throw sliders. So he's going to be a fastball slider guy.
Bramblett from the stretch. Swing and a miss. Hard cut, but right through it.
He'd be punching a change up there. He doesn't, according to scouting report, doesn't throw a lot of change. But that word is out in the dugout now. He's got a change up. You better stay back. And it was a good change up, and it really, Gideon was way out in front of that pitch.
The 0-2. He struck him out on three straight, and that's one way to come back after issuing an ugly walk to Taylor.
Well, he saw all pitches. He saw a fastball, then he got the change, and then he got the slider. So he got to see the repertoire, and it was, as you say, a good response as the bullpen got up. He absolutely came back and threw three quality pitches, all different.
Jay Statham is the ninth Aggie to the plate in the bottom of the fifth. 0-for-2. Put the ball in the air a couple of times, one in foul territory. Melton runs at second base, Logan Taylor at first. It's low and inside. Bramblett's a little bit up and down.
Yeah.
In and out of the zone.
He's given the advantage away here to the hitter at a 2-0 count in a critical situation. Jace is a veteran. He's been here a while and been in these situations before.
2-0 missed as well. I'm guessing a take sign.
I would think so.
Here. And we'll find out in just a moment. Yeah, it's pumped a strike, and it's 3-1.
I think he still wants to look for a pitch that he can drive, and if he doesn't get that pitch, he lets it go. He doesn't swing at a pitcher strike. Sit on a pitch that you're looking for in a location you're looking for.
Well, he didn't get it, and he walked. So Bramblett goes walk, strikeout on three straight pitches, and then right back to the walk. This is after the fielder's choice by Melton, and now the bases are loaded. Two outs, but loaded with Aggies, and Patrick McClendon coming to the plate, and that may be